Take my place, that you would bear my We're going to see if we can clap a little bit later in this song, so get your hands clear and ready to go.
Whoever picked the songs was feeling a little rambunctious. I didn't point fingers.
Encourage each other in the faith with word and sacrament. One announcement that I have this morning, and if you are a guest, we extend a warm welcome to you, very warm, and we just are so glad you've chosen to worship with us this morning. Pray and trust that as you do that, you'll be drawn closer to us as a church family and a community of faith, closer to the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior as well. Do have one announcement here. The Women's Ministry invites you to Pie and Prayer Day, Saturday, July 24th at 5 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Going to celebrate the state holiday with a twist, games, kids' activities, food, fireworks, maybe, I don't know, pie contest, and of course, prayer. Please see Shine Up Sheets. Please see Shine Up Sheets for shides and desserts. please see sign-up sheets for sides and desserts. Easy for you to say. Any questions, contact Andrea Graves, and her number's there. Those are all the announcements that I have. We do have this Friday at 10:30, Celebration of Life for Mark Sparkman. Hope you can come to that. There'll be a meal following the service. Looking forward to celebrating Mark's life. I know some of you, some or a lot of you, have reached out to Kim and really supported her during this time, which has really been wonderful for her. So we'll have that at 10:30 this Friday morning, and I'm looking forward to celebrating Mark's life and encouraging Kim, supporting her. Thanks for being there for her. Let's all stand for our call to worship. Bless our sins. God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us take a brief moment and ask the Holy Spirit to show us where we fall short of God's standard of holiness, confess those sins, and receive the forgiveness that we have in the shed blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
How is the time to give?
Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. By this time it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. "This is a remote place," they said, "and it's already very late. Send the people away so that they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." But he answered, "You give them something to eat." They said to him, "That would take more than half a year's wages. Are we to go and spend that much on bread and give it to them to eat?" "How many loaves do you have?" he asked. "Go and see." When they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then Jesus directed them to have all the people sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to distribute to the people. He also divided the 2 fish among them all. They all ate and were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of the men who had eaten was 5,000. The gospel. The pastor placed a basket full of apples on one end of the table with a sign saying, "Take only one apple, please. Remember that God is watching." On the other end of the table was a plate of cookies where one of the children had placed a sign saying, "Take all the cookies you want. God is watching the apples." And a priest and a rabbi were in a car wreck. Yep, they crashed their cars. It was pretty bad. Both cars were totaled, but neither one of them was hurt. After they crawl out of their cars, the rabbi says, "So you're a priest. That's interesting. I'm a rabbi. Well, just look at our cars. There's nothing left to either one of them, but we're unhurt. This must be a sign from God that we should meet and be friends and live together in peace." The priest replies, "Oh, yes, I agree. It's a miracle that we survived and are here together." "And here's another miracle," said the rabbi. "My car is destroyed, but this bottle of wine didn't break. Surely God wants us to drink the wine to help celebrate our good fortune." Handing the bottle to the priest. The priest nods in agreement, opens the wine, drinks half of it, and hands it back to the rabbi. The rabbi takes it and puts the cap back on it. "Aren't you going to have any?" asks the priest. "Not right now," says the rabbi. "I think I'm going to wait until after the police make their report." And Mark already knows the, Mark Norris knows the answer. What do they call pastors in Germany? German shepherds. Okay, moving right along. We all remember the movie Passion of the Christ, do we not? Most of us saw it. It was produced by Mel Gibson and grossed $600 million. If you've never seen it, you ought to watch it. Just know that the scenes where Jesus is flogged and beaten are gory. They're difficult. I cried. I couldn't deal with it. It was just too much. to see what he went through for me and for you in paying for our sins. Apparently, Gibson is working on a sequel, though. The Passion of the Christ, Resurrection. Jim Caviezel, who plays Jesus for the second time, said, "It's going to be the biggest film in history. It's that good." Now, the word passion is interesting. It's from the Latin word passeo, which means suffering. Com is the prefix with. So the word compassion from its Latin roots means to suffer with. We're told by Mark in our gospel passage this morning in verse 34 that when Jesus saw the great crowd at the other side of the lake, he had compassion on them, for they were like sheep without a shepherd. Jesus had planned to take the apostles to the other side of the lake to get away from the crowds. They didn't even have time to eat anything. But the crowds ran ahead of them around the lake to the other side, and they're waiting there for them when the apostles and Jesus get there. Apostles had been healing people, teaching, exercising demons out of people. Mark tells us there were just so many people there. Jesus knew the apostles were exhausted and tried to take them to a desolate place for some R&R, but no such luck. Now, Jesus could have been angry and told them all to get out of here. I need time with my boys. I need to, you know, they need to rest up. They need to recharge their batteries. But he didn't. Instead, he had compassion on them. The Greek word used here for compassion is splenkizomai. It means to be moved in one's gut for others, to be moved down deep in your bowels. Jesus had such a strong feeling in his gut about these folks that he wanted to do something about it as well. Mark tells us that he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. A two-year-old boy was tired and fretful, all out of sorts. And so was his father, who was taking care of him. It was an unusually trying day. Nothing was going right for them. As the day wore on, things became even worse. To him, everything seemed to go wrong. Dad was yelling at him at every turn he made, it seemed. It seemed that life had become one big mountain of frustration. Finally, towards the end of the day, when it seemed that he couldn't take it anymore, he toddled over to the telephone, took the receiver off the cradle, and without dialing anything, said to nobody in a voice of despair, of wanting, of desiring some tender, loving care, "Give me my mother, please." The two-year-old boy wanted his mommy to rescue him from the frustrations, the hurts, the trouble, all the brokenness he was feeling in his life. He needed someone else besides his father to turn to. He needed someone to bring some needed change into his life. He needed someone to care for his feelings, his hurts, his inability to handle the challenges of life. So he asked, "Give me my mother, please." These people were very similar, tired, worn out, exhausted, frustrated, in need of someone to care for them, just like the little boy. They came to Jesus looking for that care, and they got it. Jesus became that person for them. He became their good shepherd who had them sit down in groups on the green grass, just like the good shepherd of Psalm 23, who makes his sheep lie down in green pastures. Jesus is the good shepherd predicted by Ezekiel, Jeremiah, and Isaiah as he taught them, fed them, and healed the sick and injured. And that begs the question, if we are to be, as Luther tells us, little Christ, and Jesus had compassion on them, what are we to do? Are we to help every person we see with a sign saying, "Veteran in need of rent check, or out of work, need money for food"? The answer, I believe, is in listening to the Holy Spirit. Certainly there are scams out there, but God didn't call us to be detectives. He calls us to care, but you, and only you, can listen to the Holy Spirit and follow his lead to determine where God wants you to care and how he wants you to have compassion on others. But if we are never moved in our guts by others' suffering, then we should wonder if we really know the Lord is our Savior. Some of us give a look that keeps people who are hurting away from us. You know the look I mean. Jesus didn't have that look in his eyes when he saw all these hurting people. Jesus was like this man on the horse in this following story. It's a story told about a bitter cold evening in Northern Virginia many years ago. An old man sat by a river waiting for a ride across. His beard was glazed by snow and ice, and the wait seemed endless. His body became numb and stiff from the frigid north wind. He heard the faint, steady rhythm of approaching horses galloping along the frozen path. He watched as several horsemen rounded the bend. He let the first one pass without an effort to get his attention. Then another passed, and another. Finally, the last rider neared the spot where the old man sat like a snow statue. As the one drew near, the old man caught the rider's eye and said, "Sir, would you mind giving an old man a ride to the other side? There doesn't appear to be a passageway by foot." Reining his horse, the rider replied, "Sure thing, hop aboard." Seeing the old man was unable to lift his half-frozen body from the ground, the horseman dismounted and helped the old man onto the horse. The horseman took the old man not just across the river, but to his destination, which was just a few miles away. As they neared the tiny but cozy cottage, the horseman's curiosity caused him to inquire, "So I noticed that you let several other riders pass by without trying to secure a ride. Then I came up, and you immediately asked me for a ride. I'm curious why, on such a bitter winter night, you would wait and ask the last rider. What if I had refused and left you there?" The old man lowered himself slowly down from the horse, looked the rider straight in the eyes, and replied, "I've been around these here spots, these parts, for some time. I reckon I know people fairly good." The old timer continued, "I looked into the eyes of the other riders and immediately saw there was no concern for my situation. It would have been useless even to ask them for a ride. But when I looked into your eyes, kindness and compassion were evident. I knew then and there that your gentle spirit would welcome the opportunity to give me assistance in my time of need." Those heartwarming comments touched the horseman deeply. "I'm most grateful for what you've said," he told the old man. "May I never get too busy in my own affairs that I fail to respond to the needs of others with kindness and compassion." With that, Thomas Jefferson turned his horse around and made his way back to the White House. I have to ask you and I this morning, what look do we have in our eyes? Compassionate, or are they condemning? Helpful or hurtful? Do people think they can come to us for help, or do we have that look that says, "You made your bed, now lie in it"? Why I think we don't have compassion is because we're entitled. Bottom line, we're sinners. As Martin Luther said, we're bent in on ourselves. We're curved in on ourselves. We think we all did it the Smith Barney way. We earned it. Remember that commercial? Well, yes, you had to show up. You had to do your job. You had to be diligent. You had to do what your bosses said. You had to do it appropriately. Absolutely. But who gave you the opportunity to be in that position? Every good and perfect gift is from above. He put you there. Don't think it was a coincidence. It all happened according to his plan and because of his goodness to us. So we're not entitled to anything. You know, I hate to say this, but I got to say it. You know what we're all entitled to? Eternity in hell, separated from God and those we love who know Jesus. That's what we're entitled to, because the wages of sin is death. But God in his mercy and his grace made us alive together with Christ. For by grace are you saved through faith. It's a gift, not of works, lest anyone should boast. If that doesn't get you excited, I don't know what will. Because we deserve hell, and he gives us heaven. My goodness. The New York Times had a story about a little boy who was riding the bus. He sat so close to a woman dressed in a gray suit that everybody assumed he was her son and she his mother, until finally another lady sat down on the same seat with them. When the little boy put his feet up on the seat and got the other ladies dressed dirty, she turned to the woman in the gray suit and said, "Would you please tell your son to put his feet down because he's getting my dress dirty?" The lady in the gray suit pushed the boy away and said, "He's not my son. I've never seen him before in my life." The second lady looked at the little boy sadly for a moment and then started talking with him. She asked him if he was traveling alone. "Yes," he said, "I always travel alone. My mommy and daddy are both dead, and I live with Aunt Clara. But Aunt Clara thinks that Aunt Mildred ought to take her turn in taking care of me too. So whenever she gets tired of me, she sends me to Aunt Mildred. I'm on my way to Aunt Mildred's now." The woman said, "It must be tough traveling alone." "Yeah," said the little boy, "it is, but I never get lost." But he said, "Sometimes I do get very lonesome. So whenever I see someone with a kind face, I sit close to them and pretend that I belong to them and that they belong to me." He continued, "I sure hope that Aunt Mildred is home when I get there, because it looks like it's going to rain, and I don't like to be outside when it rains." The woman reached over and grabbed the boy, hugged him so tight that it almost hurt, and wished for a moment that this little boy who wanted so much to belong could belong to her. We don't have to pretend to belong to the Lord. We were adopted into his family in the waters of our baptisms, where we were clothed with his righteousness. You don't have to pretend that you're part of his family or that you belong in his family. You are not in his family because of anything you did. He graciously created faith in you and me and made us part of his family. By grace are we saved through faith. Remember, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. By the way, Jesus took the 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. And since only men were counted, there were 5,000 men, there were between 10 and 15,000 people, because most Jewish men were married and most of them had kids. 2 Pharisees were heard discussing this miracle that they had just seen Jesus do. And even though Jesus fed 10 to 15,000 men, women, and children, they were still feeling critical of him. They were heard to comment, "It wasn't bad, but there was no lemon to go with the fish or butter to go with the loaves." He had compassion even on those who complained about the meal. He had compassion on us when he brought us into his family through faith in Christ. Remember, John 1, 12 and 13 says, "To all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God, who were born from above, not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God." May we feel his compassion for lost and hurting people down deep in our guts, to where we do whatever the Spirit leads us to do to alleviate suffering wherever we can. And all God's people said,
anoints my head with oil, and my cup is overflows with joy. I feast on his beauty light. I will trust.
Proclaim the mystery of faith. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift up our hearts.
We lift them.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
Indeed, right beside you, we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to his holy name. And with the saints on earth and the hosts in heaven, join in their unending hymn.
Thank you. thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Lord, welcome at the table as it is the Lord's table. Come now and receive the body and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Come now, the Father's arms are open wide. You have taken communion with us here. It's all contained here in one unit, the bread and the juice. We will take it together, come up to the front, take it back to your pews, and we'll take the bread and the juice.
Forever, 'cause I know.
nobody loves me better. Hold on to me. Hold on to me.
Shed for the remission of your sins. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Friday, 10:30, Kim will We'll do the celebration of life for Mark. If he can make it, that would be great to show your support for Kim and her family. When are the kids coming in? Wednesday, Thursday?
Thursday.
Thursday. Coming in from Washington State, so we'll pray for travel arrangements for them as well. If you have a problem, need, whatever, call the office, call me at home, call me on my cell. Never a burden, always a blessing to be involved in your lives. Consider it a privilege, not a right. So just want to tell you to have a great week. Stay hydrated, and we'll see you hopefully next Thursday, next Sunday. And don't forget, Prayers with People Live, Wednesday night at 7 on Facebook Live. Now, go in peace and serve the Lord. Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.